Good morning and welcome to our summit, Healing a Broken World, which for the first time brings together cultural leaders, artists, social thinkers, and Inter-American Development Bank specialists to highlight the role of art and culture in the process of reconstruction of Latin America and the Caribbean after this difficult period of the pandemic. We often think of artists as special beings in a separate world from those of us who work in the world of development, or even more so from the public in general, as if the recovery of people's health, well-being, and the reactivation of economic growth are unrelated to art and culture. In this historical moment, the economic, social, and health challenges of the region have been aggravated. The pandemic has opened a wound in our communities. Some of people have lost dear ones, their jobs, and even their faith in the future. The consequences for emotional and mental health and the social fabric are themes that we need to confront as a society. In the IADB, we know that art and culture have always been inspiration, collective imagination, and today can be part of the solution for the creation of paths for change. take a central role in the efforts of recuperation. During the pandemic, artists and cultural centers, even with their doors closed, have been key in accompanying the public. Now we want to hear their voices and understand how we can work together in the reactivation of our communities and our economies. This event is part of the efforts of the IADB and its commitment to support innovative and inclusive ways of recuperation from the coronavirus pandemic. As an institution, we encourage countries to develop their agendas in creative industries, which have a direct impact on artists and creatives. We are working with governments with loans, public policy, generating knowledge relevant to taking informed and responsible decisions. The figures say that investment in culture is profitable. It generates employment, has a very positive social impact. With this in mind, we have wanted to bring together two groups of people who do not usually sit at the same table: the cultural sector and the decision makers and makers of public policies. The combination of their ideas and voices will help us construct a sustainable and inclusive future where nobody will be left out. I especially want to thank all the cultural institutions, museums, multilateral agencies that have come together as partners in this summit, the artists, representatives of culture. In these 2 days, together with IADB, will share their knowledge with the region and the world. A special mention for the generous participation of our main speaker, the master Gustavo Dudamel, internationally recognized for his work in defense of arts and culture for the transformation of lives. I'm sure that his work will inspire us and help us to imagine a society that is more just, inclusive, and creative in the region. Thank you very much, Maestro.
Buenos días, buenas tardes.
Good morning, good afternoon to everybody who's with us today.
Bienvenidos a la cumbre virtual, to the virtual summit, Healing a Broken World. ¿Cómo sanar un mundo herido? Mi nombre es
My name is Manuela Reyes, and I'm curator of the Unity of Creativity and Culture from the Inter-American Development Bank.
Durante estos dos días de nuestra cumbre, tendremos
During these 2 days of our summit, we'll have simultaneous traduction.
Web,
so you can go to our webpage on the upper right-hand tab,
live streaming, y elegir el idioma de su preferencia, entre inglés o español.
Their choice, English
si prefieren
Spanish.
Escuchar en todo el momento el audio en el idioma original, original de los ponentes, también pueden hacerlo en el player, que encontrarán en la página principal de nuestra web.
I would also like to take a moment to greet our English-speaking audience and let them all know that if you need English simultaneous translation, please go to the tab live streaming in our website.
Live streaming in our website to listen to the translators. Para empezar, me gustaría presentar
to start with, I'd like to present Stephen Henry Maddow, who is the co-curator of the summit with me.
Stephen es un curador
Stephen is from the United States. He's internationally recognized curator, art critic, and author of various books, including What About Activism, Sternberg Press, and Art School, Propositions for the 21st Century from MIT Press.
Es el director
He's the founding director of the Master in Curatorial Practices from the School of Visual Arts in New York
and has a PhD in modern
thought and literature from Stanford University.
I'm going to switch now to English.
Stephen, I would like you to please tell us about our summit, the concept behind it.
Thanks, Manuela. So let me begin by saying that this summit was first envisioned as a moment in the midst of the pandemic to pause and, with the better angel of our being, think about the paths ahead. Our purpose today and tomorrow is to look into and past this moment in history, to understand the many ways in which cultural leaders, artists, and experts bring their creative problem solving to share and collectively use art processes, as the artist Luis Kamnitzer says, to address the troubling issues the pandemic has only deepened. What you'll hear in this summit are large ideas and specific examples of how cultural thinking can help us institute active work toward the revision of our societies. And you'll hear and see these ideas in two ways today and tomorrow. First will be the three panels and a vision talk by Gustavo Dudamel, with our participants coming from across Latin America and the Caribbean to offer their thoughts, keeping in mind that trauma and all its upheaval is also an eruption of opportunities, of not only broad hope, but actionable planning, policy, legislation, and development. By the way, there's a website full of related information about the summit, as Manuela said, and we'll have recordings on the website, along with the publication to follow. And now for the second way the summit will be addressing these issues, through the visions of five artists whose works are premiered today under the title On the Way to Healing, I want to turn back to Manuela, my co-curator, to introduce.
Thank you very much, Stephen. Ahora voy a contarles acerca de la exposición virtual Camino a la Sanación, que estrenaremos entre hoy y mañana durante diferentes momentos de nuestra cumbre. Junto con Stephen, hemos comisionado a cinco destacados artistas y colectivos creativos de América Latina y del Caribe para esta ocasión. Son todos artistas socialmente comprometidos y activistas del Cono Sur, del Caribe, de la región andina y de Centroamérica que trabajan sobre formas de reparación y renovación de las comunidades. Las obras de arte que verán a continuación siguen la premisa curatorial que hemos desarrollado con relación al tema general de la cumbre, cómo sanar un mundo herido. Las obras expresan metafóricamente cinco pasos para sanar una herida. Estos van, por ejemplo, desde el inicio, cómo limpiar una herida, hasta quitarle al final ya el vendaje cuando esta herida ha sanado. A través de diferentes disciplinas artísticas, verán una serie de videos artísticos, entre ellos performances, acciones, intervenciones urbanas, artísticas, como también, por ejemplo, animaciones con arte sonoro. Estos actos de sanación ofrecen un contrapunto a las potentes ideas que se expresarán en los paneles de discusión y discursos que tendremos durante la cumbre. Quiero darle un especial agradecimiento a todos los artistas que hemos comisionado para nuestra cumbre. El primer día de la cumbre tendremos a Villari de Brasil, a Lorena Wolfer de México y a María José Machado de Ecuador. El segundo día presentaremos obras de Christopher Kosier en colaboración con Amir Denfenhall, Robert Jung, Swelling Shu y Luis Vázquez Laroche, todos ellos de Trinidad y Tobago. Y por último, cerraremos la cumbre con la obra de las artistas chilenas Patricia Domínguez con Nicole Lilia. Now Stephen will tell us about the next work that you will be seeing soon.
Okay, Manuela. For the next 10 minutes, let's watch the first of these commissions, a work titled Cura, Healing, by the Brazilian creative collective Bijari. Based in Sao Paulo, Bijari brings together artists, architects, designers, and video makers working at the crossroads of art and urbanism, producing works about ways to invigorate our cities as creative environments for better living. The video you're about to see is a dramatic imagining of this idea, beginning with the desolateness and danger of many cities, with islands of emptiness that traffic infrastructures often bring, in a sense, the wounds of our cities. And then they shift to positive action, to a fantasy of gritty yet magical green renewal that calls for more oxygen, more life, more vitality in our cities through creative policy change and urban planning and the work of our own hands. Let's watch Cura now.
Thank you.
Bienvenidos a nuestro primer panel de la cumbre, Healing a Broken World.
Welcome to our first panel from the summit Healing a Broken World. We've invited a very special group of panelists to talk about how creative industries, artists, and cultural institutions can inspire innovative ways of leading our communities towards better participation, economic growth and cultural inclusive growth. I would like to start with a reflection which Audrey Azoulay, Managing Director of UNESCO, talks about. The place that we keep reserved for museums in the politics of recovery from the pandemic says much about the social values that we want to defend. In the middle of the crisis, we shouldn't lose sight of the fundamental importance of guaranteeing access to culture and conserving our patrimony in all its diversity. States have a central role in supporting museums in this difficult period through ambitious cultural politics, not only to survive, but also to prepare the future. And it's about this that we want to talk with the three brilliant directors of cultural institutions and from the bank, our leader of the Andes area, Thomas Bermudez. He's also in Peru, and he was also working for the EABD in Mexico, Trinidad and Tobago, and Panama. The first of our guests is Amanda de la Garza, General Director of the Visual Arts in the MUAC, UNAM, in Mexico City. Amanda is a curator and arts historian, and her professional career has been focused on contemporary art and archives, crossing contemporary art, literature, dance, and documentary photo. Also with us is María Belén Sáez de Ibarra, curator and cultural manager. She's director of cultural resources in the Colombian National University. She's directed exhibitions as well as works and peace actions, including Quebrantes from Doris Salcedo in Bogotá. And lastly, we have Victoria Northon, who directs the Museum of Modern Art in Buenos Aires, a museum which is especially connected to the community, which, amongst other programs, has trained more than 7,000 teachers per year, as well as creating proposals for families and diverse communities, with special attention on mental health and accessibility. To start this debate, I'm going to ask each of our panelists to make a first intervention and to be able to answer some questions from the public. If you have any questions, please do it across the YouTube chat in our page. So let's start. We're going to start with a question for Amanda de la Garza. Studying the conditions of your community in the second year of the pandemic and thinking in its future as the director of the MUAC, how do you imagine that the power of culture could be used to help your community in this terrible, difficult time? What specific mechanisms or occasional projects have they developed to generate changes in the community, to think about this new globality from one level, and also to the question of territories and communities?
Hello,
everybody. It's an honor.
It is an honor for me to be here on this panel.
Thank you very much for the invitation.
Very many thanks for the invitation to the BID, to Manuela.
It's also
a pleasure to be here with such renowned colleagues.
To your question, Manuela,
I would say the first step is to accept incertitude.
To accept that museums have been
the position where cultural institutions were set after the pandemic.
So you have to
ask ourselves such questions.
How not to lose our link with our public,
how to articulate our work.
We are a university museum.
We are a university contemporary art museum.
We are a very big scale international museum.
And in Mexico, we have been closed from starting 23rd of March 2020, and we haven't been able to open our doors again.
So the question is, how to continue being a museum?
How can we continue to be a museum without having a space, a physical space?
How to produce relevant content in the middle of the pandemic? What is our role
of a crisis? What is our role
in this sanitary crisis,
sanitary and monetary and political crisis?
What are these new audiences? And the question that all of us make ourselves to ourselves, how to carry on. Obviously, the reply, one of the main things that we developed is a programmation that I'm going to now make the presentation, some of the projects that we carry out. This program, obviously, can be distributed in different areas, in different publics, in different Facebook, in different social media. In this sense, it's a line which is, what is the role of the museum? How do we consider that in the MUAC? The museum needs to be part of public space. It should create spaces of conversation, not only relevant in public policy. And this is a new function which has really amplified in the last few years. And there's been this ongoing debate about a need for a new definition of the museum. However, there still seems to be a little bit of holding back. But in the MUAC, what gives us identity is this university museum and the connection to the community. It's a public museum, publicly financed. Contemporary art has proposed muchas reflections on social problems and beyond the usual traditional conception of art. Another of the lines of action is, how do we go out from the museum? Working with communities, it's a work of a territorial work. How can we translate that to the virtual space? And also working in networks with other international organisms and museums. It's necessary to keep on an international conversation with other museums, other artistic circles, because the problems of the world are problems in common, as well as the localized and specific. The programming of the MUAC, which is in focused on this idea of delocalization. So it's updating every 15 days or 1 month with different programs for different groups of age groups and areas of interest. We also want to make the most of how the social media works.
En donde logramos, no de una manera tan planificada,
where we
de la cual sí aprendimos,
managed to achieve this, maybe not in an organized way, but sometimes surprising ourselves. Our audiences need to work all together. We need to learn a new way of being.
También la digitalidad nos permite la segmentación. Es decir,
and the digitalization, on the other hand, has helped us segmentize and direct ourselves to specific audiences. One of the priorities for the museum, since I took the direction, is to generate a conversation around rights of women and minorities. In this sense, we feel that the museum should give an echo to all these debates. And so you can follow us in Instagram, a specific queer channel that we run in Instagram, showing work, collaborative and network work with artists, with collectives, feminists, who are interested in increasing this conversation and connecting their networks. This is a very important point. When we asked ourselves, how could we work with communities?
Desarrollar esta labor. Evidentemente, eso requiere de un trabajo a largo
plazo. Obviously, this is a long-term work in order to really construct these relationships of confidence.
A lo largo de la historia del museo,
so during the whole history of the museum, we've created a very close relationship with a
enclavado el museo, es la
a working class neighborhood close to the museum. And specifically, for several years we've been working with the Zapatists. In that sense, it's a civil association.
Que requería la
and it's a work that requires a presence. And in this moment of shock, we were no longer able to see each other physically.
Sin embargo, el equipo, trabajo del MUAC,
so the team from the MUAC
una serie de proyectos
carried out a series of projects
que apuestan evidentemente al trabajo remoto,
which aim at remote work,
parten de la realidad social y de acceso a internet,
but which are also based on the social reality of access to internet. And this is a reality in the communities.
Sobre todo para un público infantil,
and so generating projects, especially for a child audience, and generating content through WhatsApp, which the children had most access to. So there we had a collaboration with other institutions in Guatemala and Colombia around sound art with children.
Aproximación, ¿no? Y un punto muy importante,
a very important point,
que señalaba es trabajar con comunidades ya organizadas.
Is to work with communities that are already organized. And that's very important for me. There's other projects which we could talk about,
implican justamente cómo el museo puede articular,
which talk about how the museum could coordinate these social actors and also continue working on wider themes. We understand ourselves as a mechanism which can connect social and territorial processes. They have to do with art, but they also beyond art.
Digamos, mi primera aproximación que quisiera compartirles y que seguiremos ampliando en la.
So my first recommendation, that's my first contribution, which I can then be amplifying as we go on. Thank you very much, Amanda. So times of difficulty are also times of opportunity.
Tú me explicabas previamente la opinión sobre cómo estamos viviendo una crisis, pero también un momento.
So now we're asking Mary Belén, how can we live through this crisis? How can we create a new relation with the planet? What actions are you carrying out as a cultural leader to help people? What specific measures have you taken to rethink current society?
Sí, estamos, tengo el privilegio de estar en la Universidad Nacional.
Yes, I have the privilege to be working in the National University.
De manera que podemos trabajar en programas de largo plazo.
So we can work on long-term projects.
Programas en donde la disciplina de las artes se borra.
The art disciplines have been very important these years. And one of the things that has emerged during these years
un territorio, un lugar geopolítico histórico hoy en día nos muestra más que nunca que estamos en esto juntos todos.
So now today we realize that the world is one unity and more than ever we are more together.
Una relación muy distinta y una intensidad muy distinta con lo que nos ocurre.
Entonces we are generating very different relation with our environment. So talking from Latin America, from Colombia,
y desde aquí, digamos, el trabajo debe ser centrado muy en la conciencia de que lo que hacemos no necesariamente.
The work should be very much aware that the work that we're doing.
Se tiene esa idea de que el arte tiende a ser siempre una vía crítica, una postura que facilita, que
It should always be a critical line. The art is a way of moving awareness.
En entender que hay diferentes lugares de donde se habla.
But I think we should be aware that art can speak from different places.
De los museos de arte, del arte.
And that museum and art
esencial,
are essential voices to contribute the debate about society.
Críticamente responsable, ¿no?
And we should be critically responsible.
Que he descubierto en este proceso. Hemos, a lo largo del tiempo, ya hemos ya más de 10 años trabajando.
Over time, we have more than 10 years working on historical memory and cosmopolitical.
Como tú decías, sí, el planeta está en una,
the planet is in a crisis.
Y en esta pandemia, que
and in this pandemic,
de crisis, seguramente, o de las relaciones geopolíticas tan conflictivas que hay en este momento,
in this
de recursos, luego de,
geopolitical de conflicts,
100 años de sobreexplotación,
and the sobre-exploitation, the over-exploitation of the environment,
pues necesitamos redireccionar,
we need to redirect
muy rápidamente y
very quickly our course.
El Catatumbo tenemos,
in Catatumbo, we have a region called the Franja of Darien.
Y tenemos, la selva amazónica,
and we have the Amazon jungle.
Bueno, esto es un país riquísimo.
This is a country very, very rich in diversity.
El programa tiene que trabajarse mucho y es lo que hemos dedicado estas.
And what we've been doing the last few years has been to deepen how does the museum politically situate itself and with what communities is it in relation, that it should be a project that is capable to contribute to social change. It needs to be firmly rooted in the experience, the specific experience of the bodies, of the communities and the territories, and politically informed of what is happening. With a conceptual clarity
de las constelaciones
filosóficas, about what is happening in the philosophical constellations and the intersections of science in this planetary vision.
Es un mundo, es un planeta,
it's a world, it's a whole planet.
Entre otras cosas, reconocerlo ausente de ese proyecto humano que supuestamente incluye a todos en el planeta. Estamos todos en esto, pero no somos uno y el mismo.
He recognized that we're all in this together, but we're not all the same.
Pero sí, incluyamos a los ausentes.
But we need to include those that are not here.
Incluyamos incluso a los muertos que aún
están salvos. Even the dead.
En esta guerra que deviene de un proceso colonial.
In this war that is now emerging. And it is part of the Colombian process.
La acumulación por despojo es la costumbre que se ha vuelto.
This custom in Colombia of original property being stolen.
De los territorios en, ubiquémonos si quieren en la Amazonía, ubiquémonos si quieren en la.
The life of the territories is in at risk.
En el sur global.
In Colombia, but also the global south.
Hemos aprovechado la pandemia para hacer muchas publicaciones, reflexionar sobre lo que hemos venido desarrollando selva cosmopolítica y memoria histórica. Estamos produciendo 4 libros muy grandes.
We're making our publishing 4 big books about the Colombian conflict.
El periodista Jesús Abad Colorado. Nos movemos siempre en esa impureza de las disciplinas.
We're always moving between disciplines and impure visions.
Y podemos trabajar con activistas.
We can work with activists, with scientists, with biologists.
Podemos trabajar con comunidades.
We can work with indigenous communities, with shamans.
Artistas.
With artists.
Y generando grupos de trabajo de largo plazo.
And generating long-term work groups.
Como guardián de la vida. Como finalmente lo opuesto a esa idea de la acumulación.
We have discovered that long-term projects really work much better, and they're the opposite of this short-term profit vision, which is really driving the world crisis, global capitalism.
Capitalismo, que es un sistema al que no podemos salir, no vamos a hacer, no estamos haciendo ninguna reflexión.
Capitalism, there is no reflection about how to leave capitalism. We need to think together about this. How to think about a collaborative ethics. In this sense, we're working on jungle and cosmopolitics. We have a very deep relationship with Ursula Beaman, an artist who has taught us so much about these aspects, necessary points to really build a program that can have an impact on the common problems.
Con Úrsula acabamos de publicar esta plataforma que va a ser lanzada muy pronto el 7 de mayo.
On the 7th of May, there will be an international launch of a new platform with philosophers.
María Belén, vamos a compartir.
Thank you very much, María Belén. We'll share now the Ursula Beaman's website.
Vamos a invitar ahora entonces a Victoria.
Now we're going to invite Victoria.
La podamos continuar la charla que ya llevamos aquí amenizada.
So let's continue chatting.
Nos comentabas en otra charla, Victoria, que los museos son agentes fundamentales para entender de dónde venimos y hacia dónde vamos.
You told us in another chat, Victoria, that museums are fundamental spaces to understand from where we come and where we're going. And so it's the moment to understand this in terms of human development. How do you imagine that the power of culture could be used to think about new ways of being in the world? How can we use the power of art for recovery after this historic trauma?
Estás en mute.
Muchas gracias, Manuela. También a Javier en Bambalinas, a Trinidad por la invitación. Estoy muy honrada de estar aquí con Amanda y María Belén. Y bueno, comentarles cómo vemos las cosas desde el Museo de Arte Moderno de Buenos Aires, que es un museo público que depende del Ministerio de Cultura del Gobierno de la Ciudad de Buenos Aires. Como dice nuestro curador senior Javier Villa, el arte es una herramienta para sensibilizar al ser humano y transformar el mundo. Y el artista, pienso yo, es un poderoso agente de cambio capaz de concebir y poner en práctica las transformaciones necesarias en las más diversas áreas de la vida económica y cotidiana. Bajo esta convicción, atravesamos la segunda ola ahora de la pandemia, luego de un 2020 durante la cual la Argentina vio
Argentina has been enclosed in a difficult. When we closed the doors of the museum, it was a really difficult decision we had to take to reinvent ourselves, to think through a digital program with more than 8,000 people getting involved. This program generated programs and opportunities to generate new contents which can face this crisis and be a relevant institution. We decided to create an archive of the present in the middle of this uncertainty. The idea is to communicate in real time work developed by the artistic and educative communities. We transformed our way of working.
De curaduría, producción, publicaciones, educación, comunicación, armamos una mesa interdisciplinaria
and created an interdisciplinary space that joined together the different departments of the museum.
Pagamos los encargos con fondos que recaudamos de donantes privados.
We fundraised with private donors and paid for work through this.
Cursos, acciones y debates. Sino desarrollar contenidos nativos.
We had to develop our own contents, not just be hosts, and develop new ways of doing art for a better interaction with our audience.
A las vivencias de la coyuntura, por ejemplo, el encierro, la pantalla, la alteración del tiempo.
So with this whole relationship of being locked down, the relationship with the screen,
la necesidad de silencio,
the necessity of silence, the necessity of connections, necessity of community, amongst more than 25 programs that we produced. We also had to reimagine our funding
activo el sistema del arte y alimentar el sistema financiero del cual el museo forma parte, sobre todo luego de una parálisis total del circuito cultural en la
There was also, a, I mean, there was a complete paralysis of the cultural circuits in Argentina during 7 months. Now we have public money that's going to ensure the 130 work posts in the museum, but now we need private money to finance the project and to get through the lockdown.
Abordamos el presupuesto del año tratando de reconstruir el presupuesto.
And now in 2021 we need to like get back up to the budget we had before so we can get the most artists possible involved in virtual and physical activities. So we understand it as a three-dimensional institution. That's what defines us today. And to select artists, taking into account the diversities of race, of backgrounds, and thus be working against hatred between people. So, for example, we did a program asking, am I racist? So we made a national inquiry to ask about what are these fears that affect us? How do we recognize ourselves without simplifying? In the program Art and Community, for example, in the area of mental health, through the work of collectives, or a huge residence program that Raúl Flores carried out. Then there was an Art in Front of the Environmental Crisis program, which enabled us to imagine artistic and educational experiences to do with environmental practices. Through 23 days, there were artists from 23 provinces of Argentina. And there was a women's art program, and there were 430 women artists involved. We love to create these proposals which are specifically targeted at different diversities, children, women, and so on.
In this sentido, me importa destacar el programa.
And in this sense, we have a special place for autist participants, and we have a program oriented specifically towards them. We really need to understand and rethink what is a museum as an element in the transformation of society. Art is a source of benefits, economic and mentally and socially. The art offers us a refuge in the middle of distances and absences and pain. And it also allows us to analyze history again. To participate in the museum is an act of change, a questioning of the society and of our economy. We are convinced that if artists were fully given the full value that they really have and including them in governmental strategy, we would have a much greater capacity for recovery. And the possibilities would be huge for our society. Art and museums should be given more value, especially at this moment, in the production, circulation of knowledge, thanks to the development of imagination and human development.
con esto termino.
So I close with this.
No, a ti, muchísimas gracias, Victoria.
Thank you very much, Victoria.
Vamos a seguir entonces escuchando acerca de nuestro último invitado.
So let's hear about our last guest.
Colegas, en este contexto que nos encontramos.
So Thomas, what actions is the EADB taking to support such a relevant sector as are the cultural and creative industries in Latin America and the Caribbean? And thinking about the role of cultural institutions and their social impact in society, what specific measures can we take to rethink society, thank you very much for inviting me here, and it's a pleasure to participate with the artists and other thinkers. In the EABD, we've been interested in the cultural sector for a long time. We have realized a time ago of their fundamental importance in the economy. They generate, these industries generate work, especially for young people.
Y toda, después que nos metimos más en el tema de, la, de las industrias creativas y empezamos a investigar en mayor profundidad.
And when we started to really deepen our investigation in cultural industries,
sobre diversas áreas de la economía,
we found their impact on diverse areas of the economy, on employment, on wages, on connectivity.
Y la creatividad sobre otras industrias gigantescas. Y eso fue parte de las cuales, por las razones en las cuales nos hemos metido.
And it's for this reason that we've really put a big focus on cultural industries. That we can generate conditions of public policy for the best development. So to take in cuenta, to visibilize the contributions and include them in the decision taking of political decisions. But in terms of what everything that we're living now, the effect of the pandemic has been terrible, but there are also hopeful points. There's been a big surge in video games, but in general, for the recovery, culture is going to be totally fundamental.
Yo, una cosa que se ha comentado esto, y por eso creo que el título que el equipo le puso a esta conferencia me parece como
The title of this conference that you've put is a really good name.
Independientemente de la nueva normalidad que tengamos post pandemia, creo que las industrias creativas,
whatever is the new normality that presents itself,
sanar el intelecto, sanar el
culture will be absolutely, it's totally fundamental to heal the minds, the bodies.
Así que creo que tenemos que hablar de su impacto, vamos a decir, y su importancia en la recuperación económica.
So we recognize fully the impact and importance in recovery of the culture. And specifically your question, what are we doing now?
Nosotros tenemos un laboratorio de innovación que se llama el BitLab.
We've opened this BitLab, which is a space for innovation and investigation.
Estamos trabajando con ellos en conectando estas tecnologías de última de la cuarta generación con industrias culturales.
We're connecting fourth generation technology with cultural industries.
Estamos haciendo vouchers de innovación y a través de estos instrumentos estamos conectando por ejemplo las industrias audiovisuales, la tecnológica con la industria de salud, por ejemplo.
Connecting also in audiovisual industries with health, for example.
Programas de realidad virtual para mitigar el estrés de los niños antes de cirugías con
procedimientos. Virtual reality programs for treating health problems.
Ese es un ejemplo de esta cosa que decía yo de combinar
is an example of this combination.
Y luego en Tegucigalpa estamos ya trabajando, por ejemplo, en un centro que se llama el Naranja Republic, que es en el Distrito Creativo Digital en el Centro Histórico de Tegucigalpa. Este es un hub de creatividad.
And we are funding like a creative hub, which is really in an old city, and it's really using technology to give value to the heritage.
El Festival de Cine de Panamá, yo creo que fue de los primeros festivales de cine que se fueron a
That was in Peru. And then also we're financing film festivals. And we're also working on how to create tools in the Caribbean and Latin America. And we're very open to all sorts of suggestions. And what we're doing now to do with the pandemic, continuing to support the cultural industries beyond what are the specific conditions of the pandemic. Well, it's been really interesting to share these different perspectives. For the second part of the panel, I'd like to
la cual desarrollamos en el BID en conjunto con UNESCO, Mercosur, Cultural, CEGIP y OEI para medir el impacto del COVID-19 en las industrias.
So we've developed a survey along with other institutions to measure the impact of COVID in the cultural economy.
Pero también, como lo mencionaba Tomás, encontramos algunas cifras esperanzadoras.
So it's been really bad news in general, but cultural organizations doubled their digital proposals. And so there's been a real focus on new audiences. But all this, of course, requires training in virtual tools and improvements in order to heal the digital divide. So I mean, I'm going to ask Amanda and Victoria about how these new digital strategies, what are the possibilities that digitalization opens for cultural institutions, generating new publics, but at the same time proposing changes within the business models.
Por supuesto, creo que la realidad post-pandemic.
Of course, I think that the post-pandemic reality is going to be digital.
Estos modelos híbridos, es decir, es un territorio ganado con muchas dificultades.
It's a territory that we've occupied with the programmation with a lot of difficulties, but we're there.
Cómo trabajar desde el ámbito digital.
How to work from the digital field.
Pero es imposible pensar que los museos van a poder sostener el ritmo de producción.
But it's impossible to think that the museums can keep up this rhythm of production.
Tiene que haber, digamos, un equilibrio.
There needs to be a balance.
No perdamos esas audiencias que son de orden digital.
Well, we don't lose the digital audiences.
En formas digitales y al mismo tiempo seguir haciendo nuestro trabajo presencial.
But at the same time, continue with our work in the physical space to keep our identity as a museum.
Por otro lado, también hemos aprendido que
on the other hand, we've also learned
globales pueden llevarse a cabo en simposios, encuentros internacionales que ocurren desde la virtualidad y que hacen accesibles
the international meetings can be held online, which make information and knowledge much more widely available than physical events would do. For example, we had this experience with the second summit of museums. This possibility of amplifying the conversation of other people getting involved, that's been really interesting from an academic point of view.
Se ha demostrado que, bueno, evidentemente, pues es mucho más interesante a veces escuchar presencialmente a alguien, pero que
and although it's often much more interesting to be physically present to listen to somebody,
y posibilidades para, digamos, para muchas instituciones.
The digital tools give us even more possibilities.
Gracias, Amanda. Entonces, voy a invitar
thank
a
you, Amanda.
A
I'm going to ask Victoria,
¿cómo ves?
How do you see the role of the cultural institution, this new digital paradigm? Obviously, it's been transformed, the institutions.
Yo me refiero siempre a un museo en tres dimensiones.
I always think about a museum in three dimensions with its public space. But obviously one of the big successes
la mayor cercanía, ¿no? Hay que pensar nosotros, por ejemplo, somos un museo ubicado en el sur de la ciudad de Buenos
Aires. So we are a museum situated in the south of Buenos Aires in the colonial neighborhood.
Y estamos trabajando muy cercanamente con comunidades artísticas y educativas de todo el país.
And we're working very closely with artistic and community groups from all over the country. So it's really enabled us to get closer to a much wider range of audiences and participants. So the museum ends up really being a kind of channel for diffusing these contents. So we're directly in contact with much more people around the country. It's a very ambitious project, for example, to train 7,000 teachers per year in Buenos Aires, physically. We had to rethink this. It wasn't easy. How do we approach the people? But we managed to do it. And we're now in touch with teachers from all over the country, generating materials for them, designed for different levels, and with various themes. And that's a closeness that's fantastic. And that really generates another program of dialogue. So there's a coming and going. We offer virtual visits to the teachers and different visions and the schools and the different territories and contribute information to the museum about the artists and creative processes of their territory. So we mutually feed each other from these two points of view, educational and artistic. It's been great to really make much more inclusive the accessibility. We've been working especially intensely with the role of children.
La manera de repensar el espacio del museo pueda ojalá informar y alimentar la creación de políticas públicas para el futuro.
So we really like thinking about the rethinking of the museum. We would want to also have an impact on public policies in the future.
Muchas gracias, Victoria.
Thank you very much, Victoria.
Bueno, les cuento a todos que mañana vamos a tener un panel en donde vamos a hablar sobre los artistas como first responders.
Tomorrow we'll be talking about artists as first responders, the capacities of rapid reaction.
Y entre ellos tendremos
and we'll have invited guests such as Luis Camnitzer, Ana María Milán, Voluspa Yarpa, and Christopher Cosio. In this sense, María Belén, we know that you've previously worked with a lot of artists on big projects. What do you think should be the role of artists and creatives in this process of recovery, and why should we listen to them?
Estás en silencio.
Sí, en particular experiencia, como te decía, en el trabajo de largo plazo con los artistas.
In my own experience with long range work with artists, we learn everything from the artists.
Lo que debemos tratar de hacer las instituciones es acompañarlos.
What we have tried to do in the institutions is accompany them.
Y una de las formas de desburocratizarla es pensar en largo plazo.
And one of the ways of doing this is to think in long term.
Que me habías invitado a hacerlo. Es una relación que lleva desde el 2014 muy intensamente trabajando, pero desde antes también la conocí.
From 2014, for example, with Ursula, we've been working, but also from beyond earlier.
Trabajar con ella en el territorio.
Working in the territory.
De 3 años acompañando.
During more than 3 years.
Ellos son los que van mostrando, van adelante de lo que una institución.
The artists go in front of what an institution can do.
Están siempre en la punta de la acción, ¿no?
They are always in the point of action.
Lo que quizá tenemos todos que priorizar es la acción.
We all need to give priority to action.
y son los artistas hacen, ¿no?
And artists make, they do. Entonces, it's a practical work.
Relación con el artista es fundamental.
So our relationship with the artist is absolutely fundamental.
Como los que nosotros queremos liderar.
For the goals that we want to reach.
¿Cómo lo pueden hacer? Pues mira,
how to do it.
Úrsula lleva más de 3 años trabajando con una comunidad.
For example, Ursula has been working the last 13 years with the Inga community in the Nariño, in the south of Colombia, to come and make a, para to imagine a biocentric university, including the other ways of life, including the invisible layers, the wood as a constellation that is cognitive, semiotic, the forest as a university, which has a huge possibility of transformation and creation of futures. So she does workshops during the pandemic. It's very important to combine.
Como dice Victoria, no puede haber una relación abstracta con el mundo.
It's not possible to have an abstract relationship with the world, as Victoria said.
Cuando tienen obras que realmente están basadas en la acción.
Artists, when they have work that is based on action, not so much on critic.
Después de 11 años de trabajar ecovisiones, experiencias en todo el planeta de la crisis medioambiental, la acción colaborativa de las comunidades.
So after 11 years of working with environmental crisis around the world, to catalog damage, to make criticisms of the extractivist model. Now we need to make a project of like making this a real participative project to include the absent people. And that's a university in becoming. So this has digital platforms, working in workshops, both physically and online, and a collective construction with different disciplines from all around the world, but and including women, shamans, community, young people from the communities. So you have to go to the jungle, use digital platforms, use technology. And use natural technologies, mix it all together. How can we help? Pues Ursula está leading a transformative process in the community when everybody is working together in this. The chaman can't do everything himself. He just has a fragment. So it's to really join a planetary project. And this human project that has been so absent, which is very connected to this idea of healing, what we're going to talk about now. Such interesting and relative projects that has so much to do with the theme of today's in the summit, this balance with the ecosystem. And through art, how we can include all these different levels of discussion and take care of our environment. So I'd like to end this part of our panel now by asking Thomas, now that he's listened to these marvelous three women, how could you include their ideas into public policy to give more strength to the creative sector? Thank you very much. I understand we're over time, so I'll try to be brief. Many of the points that came out of the poll that we carried out amongst the professionals of the sector, that we're now working in public policies. There are 5 themes that came out. First of all, the question of informality in the sector.
el periodo más del 80% de sus ingresos eran informales.
More than 80% of income in the cultural sector in the region is without being declared.
No formaron parte tampoco de muchas de las medidas paliativas.
So they were also not reached by the palliative measures and cash transfers for the pandemic.
Para mitigar los efectos de la pandemia. Entonces, trabajar en el tema de informalidad.
So we need to work on this this question of informality.
Trabajando en el sector, me parece que es un tema de política pública.
This is a question of public policy that's very important.
Hacia adelante. Y de nuevo, la informalidad es un problema crónico en nuestra
sociedad. I'll say informality is a chronic problem in all our societies.
Se necesitan programas específicos para personas.
And careers, but let's have a specific problem for culture and art. The second is finances.
Tenemos que trabajar, seguir trabajando en generar condiciones de incentivos.
We need to keep working on generating conditions for encouraging creative development.
También igual de importante, cómo acercamos al sector privado.
And how do we relate to the private section?
Que conozcan mejor y que tengan un entendimiento de
to give them an understanding of how important culture is in the economy.
El tercero es digitalización.
The third question is digitalization.
Lo que aprendimos es que ahora en el mundo que vivimos no tener parte de tu contenido de alguna manera.
We have learned that the world that we are now,
es fundamental
para the question of digitalization is absolutely fundamental to advance now in this new society.
La digitalización creo que va a ser sumamente importante generar los contenidos. Como digo, en la encuesta también salió como muchas empresas, particularmente el sector audiovisual,
So the poll that we carried out showed that many, especially of course audiovisual industries, managed to make this translation, this migration towards digital platforms. Like many museums are doing, which is an excellent work, but of course never replaces the physical presence in the museum.
Un ambiente que a lo mejor antes no llegaban y que ahora pueden alcanzar de una manera distinta. Y finalmente capital humano. Y
es and human capital.
Parte de digitalización, pero otro elemento que nosotros hemos visto constantemente y que también se vio.
Another element that's very important.
Los emprendedores también tienen que tener conocimientos básicos de cómo manejar un
negocio. They need to have a basic knowledge of how to manage a company.
Y eso no quiere decir que tenemos que formar MBAs de artistas, pero una de las cosas que hemos visto a veces es que no necesariamente temas de demanda, sino a veces conocimientos básicos.
O sea, the artists need to have a basic knowledge of management, their own finances. These are the elements we're working on, and we need to deepen that work.
Bueno, pues vamos ya cerrando este panel.
So let's be closing down this panel.
Hemos escuchado ideas súper interesantes, como por ejemplo los indicios esperanzadores que
It's been really interesting to listen to everybody. The very good points that have emerged.
The cultural ecosystem
is changing at an accelerated rate.
Esto es una oportunidad.
It's clearly an opportunity
modelos de negocio que nos comentaban acá todos los panelistas.
For business.
También vimos que hay mucho espacio para promover la creación artística.
And for the artistic creation.
Están desarrollando.
A lot of projects are being developed. The innovation that will emerge.
Y también cómo los museos son lugares desde donde repensar y cohesionar.
Y how museums are becoming places to rethink.
Hemos visto también cómo los museos son lugares donde repensar, cohesionar. Sin duda podríamos estar muchas horas.
And we could really spend hours and hours talking about this. But anyway, we have to continue. Now we're going to take a little rest. And we'll be back at 11, half past
11.
Presenting a work by the Mexican artist Lorena Wolf. A big hug to all the panelists.
La próxima exposición que viene a continuación. Muchas gracias a todos.
Thank you very much to everybody.
Bueno, se pueden despedir ahora, ya no estamos al aire. In 1959, the Inter-American Development Bank was created to modernize a region where 70% of the population lived in rural areas. Since then, a lot has changed. 75% of people in Latin America and the Caribbean live in cities today. And by 2025, one-third of the region's population will be part of the middle class. Today, the IDB is the leading source of development financing for Latin America and the Caribbean. Our mission is to improve lives. We give financial and technical support for countries working to reduce poverty and inequality. We help improve health and education and advance infrastructure. Our aim is to achieve development in a sustainable, climate-friendly way. Old challenges remain in the region, and new ones continue to emerge. The new middle class demands solutions for a better quality of life, while the fourth industrial revolution is disrupting how we communicate, live, and work. Since 2013, the IDB has been leading the efforts in connecting and listening to new talents who are a part of the creative and cultural industries, what we call the Orange Economy. The Orange Economy creates jobs, economic growth, and social impact. The income it generates is equivalent to 3% of the world's GDP, surpassing the telecommunications sector worldwide. It's disrupting traditional sectors like education, health, and transport. It grows more quickly than the rest of the economy, even during world financial crises. When the stock market falls, creativity does not. Yet its potential in our region is still untapped. By 2020, creativity will be one of the top skills in demand. The future of Latin America and the Caribbean is creative.
No, 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 no,
I'm pleased to introduce the video titled Almanac of Daily Repair by the Mexican artist Lorena Wolfer, celebrated for her remarkably powerful art that always reminds us of our civic obligation to fight for social justice. This newly commissioned work is both a vivid reminder of gender-based violence and a celebration of women and non-normative individuals for whom she's long advocated in her work and activism. Embedded in Almanac of Daily Repair is the Pact for the Other Pandemic, an ethical call to action for all of us to wipe out violence and discrimination against precisely these touchingly presented representatives of their own humanity and all of ours. In the time of the pandemic, she reminds us that this other pandemic of violence and discrimination remains cruelly with us, and against which the only inoculation is our activist efforts each day to correct these injustices through protest, resistance, and repair. Each of us can participate through this work by Wolfer, as you'll see now in the next 10 minutes.
Join the Pact for the Other Pandemic. The parties to this pact: in pursuit of gender equality in all spheres of human life, in light of the differentiated impact of the COVID-19 pandemic on the lives of women that has resulted in the escalation of gender-based violence and discrimination in the planet, acknowledging existing national and international statutes around the globe that protect and preserve women's lives and rights, yet recognizing that a profound cultural transformation is required in order to successfully dismantle the gender violence pandemic that is extended throughout the world, and granting that the expressions and severity of this pandemic vary from one person to another, from one geographical location to the next, agree as follows. One, this pact aims to motivate us as individual citizens to eradicate gender-based violence and discrimination within our lives and communities through micro-political actions. Two, in order to achieve the goal set out in Article 1, we commit to the following within our personal relationships and interactions. The daily disarmament of all the expressions of gender-based violence and discrimination that we reproduce on other people and/or ourselves. The reparation of all forms of gender-based violence and discrimination that we have perpetrated against others in the past, when possible. Our prompt intervention when witnessing acts of gender-based violence or discrimination by and against others, so long as this action does not put us or the victims at further risk. Learning about the legislation in effect within our country of residence regarding women's rights, so that we may implement, demand, and disseminate its stipulations. Three, in order to produce new visual narratives that challenge mainstream imagery which normalizes gender-based violence and discrimination, we commit to the following.
Hello, everybody. It's an honor for me to be able to be here today with you all and be part of this important initiative from the Inter-American Development Bank to talk about culture, about art in these difficult times. Art and culture connect us and inspire us, especially in these challenging times. Now is the moment to join together and heal our societies, and the transformative power of culture can help us to give form to a future for Latin America and the Caribbean. The summit, Healing a Broken World, will be an important contribution to this discussion. I firmly believe that it is during these difficult moments when we most need to come together as a society. For this reason, I have joined IADB, who have brought together cultural institutions of the Americas, to highlight the role of art, culture, and artists and creatives in the recovery of the region. This recovery should be urgently economic, but also social healing. All of society has been deeply affected, and culture, arts and identity can help heal this historical moment. I am an ardent defender of musical education and social development through art. I trained as a child in the national system of youth orchestras and choirs of Venezuela, an extraordinary program of artistic and musical education founded in 1975 by the master José Antonio Abreu. Inspired by this system and in collaboration with the Los Angeles Philharmonic Orchestra and their community allies, we formed OJLA in 2007, the Youth Orchestra of Los Angeles, a project that reached more than 1,300 musicians, bringing them instruments, musical training, academic support, and leadership skills. I firmly believe in the power of art and music to transform lives, which is why, also inspired by the system, we decided to create the Dudamel Foundation, through which we provide opportunities for meetings and inspiration for youth around the world, who thus have the opportunity to live the experience of music as a transformative element of their lives. Music and arts play an essential role in the creation of a more just and peaceful society. Music instills attention and discipline, respect for others, a collaborative spirit, and the kind of values that make us better citizens. The visionary attitude of artists, musicians, and creatives is necessary to help us find ways of healing ourselves, reconfiguring ourselves, and recovering ourselves as a society. Artists and creatives not only have the power to give form to our hopes, but also to propose alternatives and creative processes that generate new approaches. While I was in lockdown in Los Angeles, I tried out some new formats. Among them was At Home with Gustavo, a new radio program from my home. And I've dedicated even more time and energy to my mission to bring music to the youth of the whole world. It is more important now than ever that we find ways to connect and find consolation and inspiration. In crises, artists are often the first to react, imagining visionary changes for society and helping to heal our societies. This is what we have seen in this historic pandemic. The artistic vision can inspire innovative ways of helping our communities towards more social collaborative participation, economic growth, and cultural inclusion from now on. These moments of crisis are also opportunities, collective reimagining. We need to listen to the creatives from our region, give voice to culture and art in this recovery from the historical trauma that has affected our region and the world. It is the moment to repair, to heal, to inspire our communities. I invite you to continue drawing inspiration from the worthwhile voices that you are going to hear in this summit, and to imagine together a more just, more inclusive, and peaceful society through the power of art and culture. Thank you very much.
Lo que van a presenciar el día de hoy es el resultado de un trabajo muy intenso que se realizó donde muchísimos maestros de muchos países del mundo, incluyendo México, donde dos grandes artistas que estarán aquí presentes, trabajaron durísimo. Hace 5 años se nos da la encomienda de rescatar todos aquellos aquellas búsquedas, aquellos esfuerzos que se habían hecho en el país con las orquestas y coros juveniles. Entonces creamos el Movimiento Nacional de Agrupaciones Musicales Comunitarias. Arturo Márquez es un gran compositor mexicano. Hace 5 años le pedimos a Arturo, cuando comenzamos ese trabajo, que hiciera una pieza dedicada a la educación. Y compuso Alas a Malala, inspirada en la niña pakistaní.
Es una obra para niños, para jóvenes. ¿Sí? De hecho, la manera como la escribí es justamente como una especie de obra didáctica. Hay una versión facilitada. Podemos juntar a esos niños que van empezando con los niños muy avanzados, como los que escuchamos hoy, ¿no? ¿Sí?
Pieza maravillosa para orquesta y coro, que habla justamente de la educación, del conocimiento, de la cultura como partes fundamentales para la libertad, para volar justamente con estas alas.
Es un himno, a la educación, es una manera de llamar, ¿sí?, a todo aquel que esté interesado, ¿sí?, para que haga alianza con nosotros en la lucha a la educación.
Y el año pasado, Gustavo Dudamel le estrena el danzón número 9. Se encuentran, conversan, hablan de educación y Arturo le dice: Gustavo, ven a México a trabajar con nuestros niños. Primero era reunir a una selección de niños, de niñas y jóvenes mexicanos de todos los niveles. Y la Fundación Dudamel dice: bueno, queremos llevar además a jóvenes de países de América, que fue este mensaje que manda Gustavo de una única América. Entonces, de Canadá, de Estados Unidos, de Puerto Rico, de Venezuela, de Argentina, estuvieron presentes en este encuentro, estos encuentros. Entonces, poner en contacto a nuestras niñas, niños y jóvenes con este nivel de hacer música, claro que es inspiracional, es increíble, es una gran experiencia para todos.
De esta representación de lo que es la música, de lo que es el arte para la comunidad, para el pueblo. La música une, la música rompe fronteras, elimina muros y nos une como hermanos.
Thank you. Hola, muy buenos días.
Hello. Good morning. Good afternoon.
Los invito ahora a unirse a este panel.
I invite them to you all to join the second panel of the day,
sobre las ciudades y
which
los
is about cities and the challenges of the future, and how we need to think about these cities with art and culture in the center of the design process. When we think about cities, there is a general agreement that the pandemic has deepened the problems that were already being confronted. Today we want to think about a future that can adapt to this new era. What does that mean in terms of infrastructure and the challenges that are also possibilities? How are we going to work online? How will things be automated? How do we learn at distance? How to adapt industries to this new way of operating? These changes, such will mean that we need to update how the cities are constructed, how transport works, the planification, the architecture, domestic architecture, the life in the periphery. All these are areas of innovation which need to be thought about again. Today we have a super panel which we're going to talk, we'll be discussing together on these themes. What is the future of the city? What practices could be favorable in terms of this, these transformations? Above all, something that's fundamental for us, what role does art and culture have in this redesign of cities and this reconfiguration that we are now experiencing in this post-pandemic world? As Charles Landry said, some innovations will be permanent and some will be transitory. In this panel, we're going to be talking with the guests. I'm going to introduce them in the order that they will speak. First, I want to welcome Charles Landry. He's a curator from UK. He's an innovator in creative cities. He's a recognized international figure known for provoking profound urban changes and calling for making the most of the opportunities and resources to reinvent the city. His concept of creative cities became a global watchword. We also have Tatiana Bilbao with us. She's based in City of Mexico. She's been working since 2004 with the objective of including social values in architectural work. She's designed buildings for different spaces and institutions. She's also worked with the municipal government of City of Mexico, and she has a huge number of prizes and publications. Thank you, Tatiana, for coming. Another architect, Carolina Hoffman from Argentina. She's very interested in live urbanism and common cities. And she's focused on the ability to walk. And she has a master from the Polytechnical University of Catalonia. She works in a multidisciplinary way in order to strengthen the connection of people to their city with an urban and local perspective. She's also the founder of Ciudades Comunes, Common Cities in Common, with a solidarity perspective. And someone from the EADB, Tatiana Gallego. She's a specialist in urban development.
Tatiana, bueno, lleva ya varios años y ella lidera agendas relacionadas con las áreas de renovación urbana.
She leads the urban innovation areas in the EADB, as well as metropolitan policies and inclusion. She has a long career in multilateral organizations, and most recently in the South Asian Bank. I'm just giving a very brief description of their curriculums. Please do investigate these people afterwards. They're really important people. Tell me, what is your perspective on the role of art and culture in the development of cities? I'd like to make this first question to Charles Landry. And ask, how can we help to stimulate the development of cities with this cultural perspective?
We can address that at different levels. I mean, firstly, there is the big argument that culture has an intrinsic value, that it has an instrumental value, and that also the institutions of culture have a value in transmission of our values and who we are and so on. That's at a very general level. Another way of thinking about the role of arts and culture is if you think of a few words all beginning with E, arts and culture fosters enlightenment in a sense. It creates insight, knowledge, reflection, education. It helps broaden horizon, raise aspirations and understandings of our own and other culture. Secondly, by participating in culture, it is about empowerment, the second E. So you strengthen your own identity, your own capacities. But also when you engage with the widest audience, you in a sense empower others, help generate social cohesion and things of that nature. And that also helps people become makers, shapers and co-creators of their own space. Mm-hmm. The third thing is entertainment, but more than just passive consuming and recreation. By encouraging playfulness, arts and culture, fun, relaxation, it really helps imagine the types of futures that you can create for places and so on. And then also the capacity of being engaged in artistic activities helps employability, because the ability of arts and the talents and the skills embodied in it increases people's competence, confidence, communication skills, which means that these can migrate into other areas so you can work in other sectors. And then finally, of course, you know, there's economic impact, as we know, it's jobs and so on. And helps image of places, et cetera, and the attractiveness of places, all of those sorts of things. A third way you could look at it, I'm just going through different ways, is if you think of what a great place is, what you'd probably say, a great place is a place which is distinctive and where I feel anchorage, where I feel this is unique and special. And this, of course, invigorates the imagination. It makes people feel solid in who they are. Secondly, and that obviously is helped by heritage and all of these things that give you anchorage. Secondly, a great place is a place of connection with people, with one's past, here in your own city, in other places as well. The third big thing about great places is they're places of possibility, you know, where you can do things, there's an opportunities, you can fill ambitions and so on. A fourth big quality of great places is that they're places of making yourself better, of learning and so on, you know, just becoming the best you can be. And fifthly, really importantly, great places are places that inspire in some way. They get beyond the normal. We all know that we need to be feed ourselves and have jobs and all of that. But this extra register, this extra thing that you could even call spiritual, if you like, is an incredibly important thing that makes people feel at ease in a place. Now, all of those elements, anchorage, connection, possibility, learning, inspiration, in every one of those aspects, which are some of the cores of making a great place, the arts and culture play, can do, and they do play a central role. Now, the other thing, of course, is the creatives involved in arts and culture are, of course, great storytellers. And when you're trying to blend together complicated institutions, organizations, people, and all of that, that mix and blend of a city together, you need a story that somehow joins the threads of what we are all about together. So that storytelling is really important. And I often say, look, let's switch the question. So many people ask, hey, what's the value of culture and creativity and art and all of that? Which puts you on the defensive and says, why don't you justify what you're doing? I always say, what's the cost of not? What's the cost of going not recognizing arts, culture, and creativity? Because what you then can see is the way places don't work, the way there is no civic generosity. What you feel is those places are really, empty and void in some way. So just think of any place that you like, any place you enjoy, any place you feel comfortable in, you will feel and know that those sort of activities, arts and cultural activities, the institutions around them are strongly there. But of course, they have to be open ones. They mustn't be too exclusive. They must allow you to meld the everyday cultural activities into the more formal. And so this thing about the mainstream and the alternative is very important to encourage both, because the alternative often pushes the mainstream to think afresh. And then in turn, that then when you think afresh, it might reinvigorate what the place can be. And I don't need to tell all of your audience that, you know, rethinking often heritage and giving it new uses is the thing that gives a real sense of a patina of ages, which in a sense gives people that sense that there's depth to a place. It's not just a bland place floating in the sky into nothingness.
Fantástico, Charles. Me gusta mucho cuando
dice esto de
cuál es el costo.
I like a lot that you asked the question, what is the cost of not including art and culture?
Tener estos espacios que son vacíos, pero que son sin identidad, en un momento en que hay una herida en nuestra sociedad.
In this moment when our societies are wounded, it's precisely this way that we can really fight against and to heal this wound. Now we'll like to introduce Tatiana. Thank you very much for coming to the panel. We had a few conversations before you came, and I very much liked your reflections.
Si tuvieras que pensar la ciudad post pandemia, ¿qué cosas cambiarías? Sobre todo, ¿qué cosas?
And if you had, one of the things I asked you was, if you had to change the post-pandemic city, what would you change?
Quisiera pensar entonces que si tuvieras que pensar esta ciudad post pandemia, ¿cómo qué es lo primero que te viene a la mente?
What's the first thing that comes to your mind?
Estás en mute.
As Charles was saying, and sorry for that, I think that there are many ways of really reacting towards the understanding of opening new possibilities for cities, no? But I think for me, and obviously because of my bias that I'm an architect, I believe that creativity needs to enter the domestic realm. Mies van der Rohe said in 1931, the housing of our time does not yet exist. However, the transformation of the way of life demands its realization. I don't think we can think of something more present, more actual today than that that sentence. And I think that the house is a, we have learned all, no, probably, how important the house is. For those privileged that we have understood that that doesn't probably is what a decent and enjoyable life means. But that is probably 10% of the population in the world. Let's think that there's 90% of the population that they don't have a house that protects them and protects them in a situation like this. Creativity needs to come in because the house is the fundamental component that structures our everyday life and defines for sure the relationship of our bodies and the people. The house obviously is a super contested and manipulated space by social, political, and economical forces. But I believe that if we are not able to find an understanding of how to create a space that becomes a platform for everyone to create their own experience and their own life, their own existence, I think we will be really impossibilitating the future or the sustainable future of our cities and our lives. No? In Mexico, dignified and enjoyable housing, a place to live, is a constitutional right. And this is not the case in many countries, but the right to live has become a human right in the world, and it is the law in many of the countries. That dignified, enjoyable, and affordable space is what some of us right now have. Does that really allow us to create a living? I think the unfortunate situation is that we have really not thought from the core. No, what do we need to exist? We need to take care of ourselves. As basic as that. And right now, to be able to take care of ourselves, we need money. We need to be productive. So right now, we can say that to exist, we need to produce. And we should really go and think that we need to exist to then produce. So to exist, we need a lot of reproductive and care labor that right now is relegated, not to say to only women, but it's not a paid labor and it's not a recognized labor, although it's the most important labor we have done. Where is that done in our houses? And how is that done right now, hyper precariously? It's been relegated to a mere functional fact, to a non-paid job, whereas is the most important one. Where were those rituals that allow us to think and to understand the importance of care of our body, of ourselves, of our other, of our community, and therefore our nature? So I believe that if we really include creativity in the possibility of transforming the domestic realm, we will be then able to kind of, as a domino, immerse the cycle of becoming more sustainable, in a virtuous circle rather than a vicious circle that we are right now. And I say that we all do have to sleep, right? But we don't all need a bed of X size and a room of X size to sleep. Ask the Mayan people, they don't sleep in beds. We might be thinking that it is impossible that no one sleeps in a different place than a bed. But they think that it's impossible to sleep somewhere else. Or a bathroom. Where did we lose the possibility of the understanding of the ritual, of taking care of our body, of really sharing this place with others? And we have relegated to a mere functional way that sometimes this place is not even naturally or artificially illuminated. So I would say that there are many ways of understanding the domestic realm differently from what we have been really doing today. And I think it's imperative that we start thinking on creative ways, how to share domestic labor. What about sharing kitchens, sharing bathrooms, sharing spaces, having privacy, but having common spaces? I believe also that we have been binarizing our relationships in a more imperant way every day. No, so we have the private realm and the public one. We relegated the health from instead of really thinking of health as a comprehensive thing. Right now, I'm speaking of health because of our current situation. We have relegated health to the institution. Same with education. I'm not saying that institutions shouldn't exist, but what happens if we think that the house becomes the most important protective space, that is the most important learning environment, the most important health environment, and the most social, importantly, space? And how can we start scaling our spaces from the domestic realm to the public realm in order to acquire the possibility of having much more a sustained collective relationships. And I believe that then therefore, still, as Mies van der Rohe said, the house of our times yet do not exist. And the transformation of the way we live right now demands its realization.
Muchísimas gracias, Tatiana. Súper interesante, porque la verdad es que lo que estás hablando es cómo poner el cuidado al centro de
very interesting because what you're talking about is putting care in the center of the vision.
Lo que habíamos estado poniendo al centro de la ciudad y cómo hoy día esta pandemia ha demostrado que esa estructura se quebró.
This pandemic has showed how we need to change the center.
Familias grandes sin cuidado, sin poder salir. Todo eso quedó realmente como algo que no funciona. Ahora me gustaría conversar, invitar y darle la bienvenida a Carolina.
Now I'd like to welcome and ask to chat Carolina.
Carolina desde Buenos Aires, muchas gracias por
She's accompanying us from Buenos Aires. Thank you very much for coming.
Ha sido una charla muy interesante contigo mientras preparaba.
I had a very good chat with you while we were preparing this.
Lo clave y esencial que es lo cultural para entender y articular el territorio y la construcción
understanding
de la ciudad.
How culture and
y tomando
art
esta premisa
so
desde tu aproximación al urbanismo centrado en la persona, ¿cómo ves que debemos enfrentar este proceso hacia el futuro? Y sé que además
esto me llevaste
tu propio grupo de trabajo, así es que me encantaría conocer cuáles han sido esas reflexiones.
I'd really like to know what you're thinking about
bueno,
this.
Muchas gracias por la invitación.
Thank you very much for the invitation.
Como decías, lo llevamos al trabajo de nuestro equipo esta pregunta que nos hicieron.
O sea, this question we talked about it all the group of work group.
Lugar, ¿no? El primero que habla de la cultura general y la gran pregunta que queda es ¿cuál es el costo? Y lo segundo
o sea, the big
que es,
question
lo
is
lo común,
what is the cost of culture?
Público y la cultura,
and then
que a nosotros,
what is the contribution
desde trabajos,
to public space?
Nos dedicamos a hacer proyectos que tienen que ver con el vínculo entre las personas y la ciudad.
For us, we work on projects which is the connection of people with their city,
este panel,
with a local focus and human.
En poner el eje en la cultura y en la
and
ciudad,
putting the really the emphasis on the culture and how we can immediately apply this.
Que tiene que ver con la relación entre el espacio que habitamos y la cultura.
It has to do with the space that we inhabit and culture.
La diaria. Que entonces,
the daily inhabitants.
¿Qué entendemos por lo cotidiano? Que es básicamente una de las patas. ¿Y por qué es tan importante? Y entender lo cotidiano tiene que ver con entender nuestro propio ser.
We're really talking about
entender
everyday.
Cómo esto está enlazado de forma directa
what is the
con el
everyday?
Estar.
It's the
entender
correct direct connection with what's
es
around.
Es un comportamiento aprendido.
It's a learned behavior.
Que no son innatos,
they're not bred in. They're habits that you learn.
Expuestos a espacios, a lugares,
and their responses on a physical level to the environment that you're in.
A partir de la repetición de esto que se consolidan. Y a partir de la consolidación es que uno puede identificarse.
This then gets consolidated and their identity emerges.
Que va continuamente moldeándose
and that's continually being molded depending on how the environment changes.
Conforma, y que entonces uno puede entenderse e identificarse con la comunidad de
but
la
this is on this depends how you identify with the community and with your environment.
Y habita los espacios públicos de nuestro alrededor y que básicamente va marcando y construyendo
so these public spaces go constructing our city. Where do we belong? To who do we belong?
Tiene que ver con lo colectivo.
How do we? How are we part of the collective?
Me parece muy hermoso cómo viene todo el con en relación a cómo salimos de nuestro lo doméstico que decía Tatiana.
I think that's really nice. After Tatiana's talk about the domestic sphere, how this connects to the public sphere.
Pensar cómo esto se refleja en nuestra cultura cotidiana.
Think about how this reflects on our everyday
culture. La cultura, porque
and it has to do with reproducing
excluye,
culture.
Es tiene algunas cuestiones de inequidad. No vamos a hablar de los machismos que
so there's a whole question of inequalities of machism.
Pero que tiene que ver con poder trabajar con lo cotidiano.
But it's coming back again to how do we work with the everyday matters.
Y de transformación hacia la inclusión y la integración.
That transformation towards inclusion needs to take place in the everyday arena.
Desde nosotras mismas también.
From ourselves, in our own work.
Invito a todas las que trabajan.
All of us that work.
De preguntarnos siempre, porque también son nuestros patrones.
We should always be asking ourselves. because they're our ways of behaving and their constructions. Who isn't here? We should always ask ourselves, who isn't here? Who are we missing? Because what we believe is that we should be happening in everyday life is the integration of all those sectors. Questioning, who isn't here?
Entonces, nosotras creemos realmente que la cultura cotidiana es un reflejo de cómo nos vinculamos.
We believe that everyday culture is a reflection of how we relate to the collective and to our environment.
Es el punto de partida,
it's the point of departure
creación y tiene que ver con
for the creation. I mean, it has to do with action.
El foco en lo cotidiano y que nos permita
this focus on the everyday matters.
Para esto nuestros trabajos, que voy a hablar de esto porque si no se me va a pasar el tiempo, pero que nosotros trabajamos con esto desde la transformación de espacios físicos.
Because we work with this idea transforming physical spaces.
A los comerciantes, que tiene que ver con poder integrar a los niños y niñas.
And integrating all from like shop holders to children. And we're like really with a playful approach.
Y desde los vecinos y vecinas en un proyecto que tiene que ver con microhistorias.
And then we have a project with neighbors
de lo cotidiano del barrio.
Again with the neighborhood everyday life in the neighborhood.
Con niños y niñas,
including children. We do workshops, walks.
Un callejón al lado de una escuela.
We did a project in a small road beside a school.
Daba muchísimo miedo,
which was like a really scary place.
Amable de juego. Por ahí sí,
through games we transformed it.
Uno se puede de
so
espacio,
in that daily life you can appropriate that space.
Festival de caminatas es un proyecto
we did a festival of walks as a cultural festival,
poder registrar y percibir la ciudad,
which is to do with being able to see the city in another way. Having a walk over the weekend as we're chatting and sharing points of view, asking a lot of questions, where we live, where is culture, why?
Y por último, y lo que decías de la región, ¿no? Y de todo este movimiento que circula por nuestra región latinoamericana.
And then what you were saying about the region.
Tiene que ver con ciudades comunes.
We have a project called Common Cities in Common,
donde conectamos a nivel
where we connect
latinoamericano
at the level of America, Latin America,
con la participación ciudadana,
with projects that have to do with citizen participation.
La importancia de que la toma de decisiones,
that the taking of decision,
de quiénes son la pregunta de quiénes son estos tomadores de decisiones y quiénes estamos co-construyendo la ciudad.
We're asking always like who is taking decisions, who are we that are constructing the city, putting the everyday culture in the center of decisions.
Nuestra propuesta,
our proposal,
es que el trabajo, la toma de decisiones,
is that taking of decisions
un trabajo con las personas,
needs to be a work with people.
Desde el principio,
they need to be involved from the beginning.
Donde desde la previa, en el durante y en el después.
From before, during and after.
No aparecen las personas en los procesos de gobierno en proyectos.
Often people don't appear in government projects.
La vida cotidiana, lo que se ve reflejado en el habitar diario.
We need to include that everyday life.
De forma inclusiva e integrada para poder crear espacios inclusivos.
In order to create inclusive spaces.
Y si estamos abriendo, abramos y abramos, incluyamos.
We are opening, and so we're including.
Y demos otras posibilidades y transformemos espacios para ver qué otra cosa puede haber ahí.
And there are other possibilities for transformation to give us surprises, unknown possibilities.
Y quiero pasar un videito muy corto.
I'd like to show a short video.
La cámara me sigue y me toma el video. Este es el bajo autopista de San Telmo.
It's in the highway of San Telmo.
Niños y niñas que
here are
San
children
trabajan
in
en
San
la calle.
Telmo.
Los chicos salen a vender en la calle.
Who work in the street.
Estábamos haciendo durante toda la pandemia un proceso participativo digital.
During all the pandemic, we've been doing a collaborative process.
Se podía incluir. Entonces decidimos crear este espacio.
So we decided to create this space in the street.
Todos los días trabajan.
Where the children work every day.
Y de pronto, por 10 segundos literal,
and
lo que dura este video,
just for 10 seconds,
dejaron de trabajar,
they stopped working,
para jugar,
into play again.
Cotidiano. Esto es el día a día.
And this is the everyday life.
Por unos minutos, les cambió el día.
And just their day changed even for a little short time.
Para poder transformar la vida cotidiana de cada uno.
So we need to work on this space in the city to transform everybody's everyday life.
Muchas gracias, Carolina. Increíble, porque por esos 10 segundos.
Thank you, thank you very much. Incredible. For those 10 seconds, children became children again.
Y la verdad es que tú has hablado y nosotros cuando hablamos del arte y la cultura.
When we talk about art and culture.
Estar en la mesa de decisiones es también esa cultura.
Being involved in the taking of decisions, it's also this everyday culture, which is often missing in these decisions.
Cultura y arte y otro. Y no, es una misma cosa. Entonces,
and separated from art and culture in a high sense, but they're really the same thing, everyday culture and high art. So we're now like inviting Tatiana Gallego, she's from the EADB, from the Urban Development Division.
Y Tatiana, a mí me encanta esto porque Charles Landry habla de los burócratas creativos y nosotros conocemos burócratas creativas.
I love it that Charles Landry talks about creative bureaucrats. I want to be one of those.
De tu división se ha trabajado
and your mission
en el tema de las ciudades creativas.
To work on creative cities.
Sobre estos temas y cómo pueden ser parte también central para el desarrollo económico de la ciudad. ¿Cómo estos temas pueden ser?
How can art and culture form the heart of development of the city?
Políticas públicas y me encantaría que nos
and affect public policy.
Algunos proyectos que tiene el banco donde realmente ya se está poniendo.
I've heard of some projects that the EADB has which are applying this.
No, gracias a ti.
Thank you to you, Trinidad, for the opportunity. And to be able to share with this super session with such specialists.
Realmente inspiradores. Una de las cosas que realmente ha sido fabuloso durante la pandemia.
One of the things that has been amazing during the pandemic has been the question of culture.
Y eso nos está ayudando mucho.
Which has been really helping
en esta nueva ola de la pandemia.
To confront the new wave of the pandemic.
Sinceramente ha sido siempre un elemento fundamental.
Culture has always been a fundamental element in cities. It's the heart.
El centro,
it's the center.
Digamos que separa el carácter de una ciudad de otra.
Which distinguishes the character of one city from another.
Han sido espacios de encuentro.
Cities have been spaces for meeting, for social interaction.
Han promovido el intercambio de ideas.
They've promoted the exchange of ideas.
Como mencionabas, la creatividad
and creativity and innovation.
Pero con el tiempo nos hemos ido olvidando.
But we've also been forgetting.
Por ejemplo, quizás la arquitectura.
Perhaps architecture has been an artistic expression that has been very visible in the urban landscape. But in the urban landscape, there's also other forms of culture,
como pueden ser las artes visuales,
like visual arts,
el maravilloso, digamos, trabajo que nos enseñaba ahora Carolina,
or the fantastic work that Carolina showed
us. También hay otras formas, digamos, de valor patrimonial,
but there are also other forms of heritage value, like festivals
o la gastronomía, o sea,
or food.
Río no sería Río sin su carnaval.
Rio de Janeiro wouldn't be the city it is without its carnival. And Valencia without its fires, in terms of food.
Digamos, otro tipo de elementos,
we have other types of elements
ese sentido de pertenencia,
which affect our sense of belonging
y que obviamente luego le dan carácter,
and
digamos,
give character seen from outside.
Más allá de una dimensión material,
I think there's also a material dimension
se encuentra ligado a prácticas cotidianas, como mencionaba
connected
Carolina,
to everyday practices.
Prácticas cotidianas sociales y culturales que además los habitantes han desarrollado,
which the inhabitants have developed and they've evolved.
Cuando tenemos ciudades que han integrado,
for example, when we have cities that have integrated a lot of migrants,
hemos llegado a crear una especie, digamos, de melting pot.
How have we managed to create a sort of melting pot in these cities?
También con un espíritu, digamos, dinámico.
So that these cities grow with a dynamic spirit, which is really productive.
Desde el BID estamos muy
in the IADB,
y como bien mencionaba,
we're very aware of this.
Lanzamos un nuevo programa,
and we launched in 2019 a new program to support cities in Latin America and the Caribbean, which we call Living Heritage. And the living is really the important here.
trata de capturar el carácter.
Porque it tries to capture the character and the evolutionary process that each city has. Living Heritage is a sectorial program aimed at strengthening the abilities of cities to promote conservation and valuing heritage, but also serving to catalyze economic, environmental, and social issues, and also to strengthen the cultural identity and development of the city. And now we're coming out of the pandemic. These three elements are absolutely fundamental. To give a bit of context, the inclusive approach supports the social on one side, and then the question of re-equilibrium.
Por ejemplo, de asegurar la permanencia de residentes vulnerables en sus barrios.
For example, ensuring that residents who are vulnerable can stay in their neighborhoods.
O simplemente de la inclusión de género.
Or just including a focus on gender or race in the policies. The question of production of economics tries to promote local economies through searching for talent and also creating work. But also, and also trying to promote tourism and to promote the activity of walking and also these amazing creative industries that we have in the region. And we're trying to reduce the vulnerability of populations.
De la gran exposición a digamos a fenómenos climáticos.
For example, climate change, which affect the region.
A través de un desarrollo de capacidades, sobre todo comunitarias.
Through the development of community capacity. But also for risk prevention.
De lo que es la integración de lo que son las estructuras patrimoniales.
And the integration of our heritage.
Dentro de lo que es un desarrollo urbano.
Within urban development.
Hemos trabajado un poco en todas partes en la región.
We've worked all over the region.
Tenía San Telmo porque
I love San Telmo that Carolina mentioned San Elmo in Buenos Aires.
Los barrios patrimoniales desde los que arrancamos.
Because it was one of the neighborhoods in which we worked. We've also worked in Ayacucho in Peru, in Montevideo in Uruguay, and in Panama.
Y esperamos seguir trabajando.
We hope to continue working on this line.
De forma colaborativa.
In a collaborative way.
Gracias, Trini.
Thank you very much, Trinidad.
Muchas gracias, Tatiana. La verdad es que es apasionante el trabajo.
It's really amazing the work that's being done with the Living Heritage.
Se ha hecho y se sigue haciendo desde esta.
That is going on still.
Y lo que es más interesante es que se hace en conjunto con otros.
And it's really interesting that it's being done together.
Con la región y se incorpora esta mirada.
With other groups and levels of organization, including creatives and artists. Who are in the city.
Gracias, Tatiana,
so thank you very much, Tatiana.
Por esto que nos cuentas, que creo que puede ser muy interesante para nuestra
audiencia. I think it could be really interesting for our public.
Y me gustaría volver con Charles.
So I'd like to come back to Charles.
Y Charles, con Charles tenemos grandes conversaciones.
We've had super conversations with Charles.
Muchas veces en estas conversaciones hablamos de que tal vez.
And often we talk about how we're living.
Momentos.
One of the transformative moments of humanity
que ha tenido manifestaciones que culturales,
which it has cultural manifestations
que nos han llevado también a reevaluar cuáles
which have led us to reevaluate
detrás de todo esto que estamos hablando
what is lying behind everything we're talking about.
Mencionaste en tu primera
you mentioned in your first intervention how humanities and art can help us.
I mean, the big transformative moment we've just been going through, which of course is the pandemic, and what that's focused on is what really matters. Obviously, health, there's the psychological dimension, the economic, and so on. But what it's also told us is what we've lacked. And what we've lacked, obviously, is the ability to embrace, hug, to socially connect, proximity, and that sense of the collective experience. And so one of the big issues in that is that. The second point is that transformation projects themselves are cultural projects in the bigger sense, in the sense that they're about ethics, values, mindset, attitudes, hearts and all of that, hearts and skills and so on. And so seeing that, which is also about behavior change, is an important dimension. So what we're really talking about when we talk about culture and creativity, we're talking about the whole realms of culture, from the widest to the narrowest, to the specific arts project that exemplifies something, to the broader concept of how we live. And why people sometimes find it difficult to see the power of culture is that it's embedded like electricity through and the nervous system of everything we do. And I think it's the most superior way of thinking. In short, what we really need is cultural literacy and basically planning culturally and acting culturally, which means having that sensitivity of where places come from and where they can go.
Me encanta, Charles.
I love it, Charles.
Aquí vamos a ir un poco más rápido, pero
so let's go a bit faster.
Tatiana,
I have a question for Tatiana Bilbao.
La pregunta que yo tenía preparada para ti, Tatiana, si es que la voy a leer.
I'm going to read it out.
Aquí nos dicen, ¿cómo hacemos para rescatar la función del descanso, del recogimiento,
what
del
should we do to,
de las amenazas externas y de desconexión del
to
trabajo?
To protect the question of relaxing, of taking care of oneself after the in the face of the omnipresence of virtuality. I think it's a really important question. And I think we certainly have to actively understand that we need to, to generate spaces. We need to understand how the rituals of care and the essential necessities of the body should be in the center.
Una posibilidad de esos lugares.
So there's a possibility
el problema
that
hoy creo es que no tenemos, bueno,
right now, today,
pero tampoco tenemos el espacio.
We don't have even the space or the customs.
De alguna manera la casa se ha vuelto este espacio que tiene
que encontrar. Now home has become a space of presentation.
Ya sea por necesidad ahora por la pandemia.
Whether by the necessity of the pandemic. Or everyday necessities.
Creo que en otros es porque no existe el lugar físico en el cual.
In many cases, there's no physical space in which to celebrate or to hold digital meetings.
Sociales, en otros lugares, los encuentros privados con uno mismo, ¿no? Y creo que es algo que realmente necesita.
I think we really need to work on this. And we need to like define a space to live the digital. We haven't integrated it. We've just automatically assumed it. And it's a really interesting opportunity to rethink our spaces. Fantastical. Now we're going to go in with Carolina Hoffman. I liked very much that you spoke about children, and children have suffered a lot during the pandemic.
Cuando pensamos las ciudades, pensamos en ellos.
When we think about cities,
tenemos poquito tiempo, pero me encantó esa experiencia que contaste.
I'd like you to elaborate a bit more on how children live in the city.
Depende qué estamos pensando, si se lo piensa o no.
Depends on what we're analyzing.
Del incluirlos desde otro lugar.
We need to include them in another way.
No solo pensarles.
Not just think about them.
Y porque muchas veces.
Often,
así como en algún momento,
in some moment,
el modernismo,
we have criticized modernism and the way of building cities centered on the white man,
desde arriba, y ahora,
looking down from above.
Desde poder integrar,
ahora, now we have a different focus from the bottom up.
Los usuarios, que le habitan. Los niños y niñas no solo son partes, y las personas mayores también, sino que digo, como hay una clave de donde estos dos
old people and children
estén cómodos en el habitar de esta ciudad,
if they are happy living in the city, then everybody between those age limits is also happy.
Del registro, de los niños y niñas, de otra escala de humano.
So it's another, for example, it's another scale of human, the children.
Nosotros, a medida que nos fuimos haciendo grandes,
we're getting bigger.
Fuimos perdiendo, fuimos transformando, fuimos mutando, adaptando.
And we transform, we mutate, we adapt ourselves.
La piel más gruesa.
Making our thin, our skin thicker. Things that shouldn't be, we tolerate.
Cosas que deberían registrarse.
And things that we should observe as elements to change. We need to listen with this other look, not which doesn't belong to the office, but it's from or is the children. And they're so specific and sensitive, and so we need to focus really a lot on games, for example. I could give them a lot more space to children to play. Once we talked with the mayor of Tirana in Albania, and he said that children are the spokespeople people for changing the city. With Tatiana, we spoke a lot.
Pero ¿qué pasa con estas ciudades que han tenido que como repensarse y los centros culturales que en general?
O sea, we've thought a lot about cities and what happens with these cities who have to reinvent themselves and above all their cultural centers.
Está preguntando, dice, bueno, ¿qué pasa con esto, estas ciudades que van a tener que replantearse y en general los centros culturales están más bien en las zonas céntricas?
And usually the cultural centers are in the centers of the cities.
¿Cómo ve esa realidad?
How do you see that reality, Tatiana?
Gracias, Trini.
Thank you, Trini.
Las ciudades de América Latina y el Caribe en general son ciudades relativamente densas.
Latin American cities are generally quite dense.
Lo que se ha estado implementando, digamos, de política de uso de suelo,
but the implementation actually of policies of urban use, there's a move towards the outsides, as you've mentioned, the historical centers.
Los centros de negocios, pero nuestros centros históricos con el tiempo, poquito a poco, habían ido perdiendo,
with time,
digamos, su densidad,
have been losing population,
y muy a menudo habían caído en un estado
and
un poco
often,
digamos, de abandono,
fell into a state of disrepair.
Poco cuidado del espacio público,
the public space not cared for, and the infrastructure
y al final,
neither.
Digamos, ese abandono había terminado haciendo que hubiese un aumento de la, digamos, de la criminalidad.
O sea, este disrepair meant an augmentation of criminality.
Gente que quisiese vivir.
And so most people wouldn't want to live in these
maravillosas
central areas,
son el alma de lo que tradicionalmente,
which are really the soul
of
what we consider traditionally as the city.
Desde el BID llevamos ya muchos años trabajando
in the
IADB,
we've been working for a long time in urban regeneration. And this program of Living Heritage that I shared a little while ago is a lot to do with this, not just on the architectural level, of the material part of historical city centers, but also in the recovery of traditional crafts and inhabitants. It's also important to take into account what the Anglophones call city business districts, the centers of business.
Un vacío porque,
it's been an emptiness because there's a progressive transformation. We don't know if it's going to last. People are much more used to living
trabajar, digamos, en sus ciudades,
or working in their cities,
en sus barrios,
in their neighborhoods,
trabajar en sus casas, como
to work in their house at home,
anteriormente,
as Tatiana pointed out.
A vivir mucho más en sus barrios,
and so living much more in their neighborhoods compared to us before, which they only saw in the evening or the weekend.
En la transformación de lo que son estos centros,
so we need to work on the transformation of these business districts,
de comercio,
which have been traditionally
de negocios,
dedicated to business or
y ahora
commerce,
se pueden transformar,
but which now have an opportunity to be transformed into new neighborhoods with a different character, with a residential character as well as a commercial. And that's where culture has a very important part to play
y un rol que permita darle carácter,
to give character,
y promover y políticas
equitativas, and promote inclusive policies,
tanto Tatiana Bilbao
as como Tatiana and Carolina commented,
para asegurarnos de que,
to make sure that it's for everybody.
Gracias.
I'll stop there. Thank you, Trinidad.
Perdón. Muchas gracias, Tatiana.
Thank you, Tatiana.
Solo quiero, voy a terminar
por now I'm going to close by just thanking everybody.
Por supuesto, a Carolina Huffman, a Tatiana Gallego, a Tatiana Bilbao y Charles Landry, por supuesto, y en especial a Tatiana Gallego.
Thanking everybody and especially Tatiana Gallego, who's been supporting us in the whole design of this summit, to put the culture and arts in the center of the conversation around public policy, in this case for the design and thinking about cities. Thank you for everybody and enjoy the rest of the program. Hasta luego.
Es un honor presentarles a la artista ecuatoriana María José Machado.
It's an honor to present everybody.
El performance y la práctica comunitaria.
Artist, María
Adicionalmente,
José Machado,
es gestora, docente y productora cultural. Fue nombrada artista del año en la Bienal Internacional de Cuenca en el 2018.
She was named Artist of the Year in the International Biennale of Cuenca in 2018, and her work has been shown internationally in places like the Museo del Barrio in New York. She's actually working around the idea of the social function of art. Now we're going to show her video of the action, which is a part of the third step, changing the bandage to avoid old infections. Her work, called The Empty Chair, reflects about the impact of the pandemic in education. It shows us how art and education connect catharsis and healing. Her work tries to assure that our methods and our listening would be transformed in and not just in words, but really take their place in public policy. The video lasts about 15 minutes. It's recommended to use headphones.
La pandemia fue muy reveladora en muchos sentidos, en temas de salud, en temas de educación, en temas económicos, en temas políticos, mucho más. O sea, de lo mal que están todas las cosas, de dónde se están enfocando las energías y hacia dónde deberían ser enfocadas.
Antes yo creía que solo eran vacaciones por 2 días y ha sido ya más de un año. Entonces ya no voy a volver a ver a mis profes y a mis compañeros.
No me esperaba de que iban a suspender la clase. ¿Y qué se iba a extender tanto tiempo? Pensé que era solo un par de semanas o meses, pero no. Ya vamos un año así de sin asistir a clases presenciales.
Yo lo que más extraño de la escuela es jugar, ir al recreo.
Extraño mis maestras, porque son muy buenas conmigo y con todos mis compañeros.
Extraño mucho la escuela, jugar con mis compañeros, abrazarlos, cantar, jugar. muy duro dejar de ver a mis amigos, estar virtualmente, no poder estar más tiempo con ellos, estarme cayendo del columpio, ni estar ahí, por ejemplo, sacando los lunches cuando sea.
Para mí esta experiencia ha sido un poco difícil porque estoy acostumbrada a verles a mis amigos todos los días y en la pandemia se cortó todo.
Un poco como solitario.
Y están perdiendo los mejores años de su vida. Están perdiendo el espacio donde forjas las amistades, donde la amistad realmente es sincera y sin interés. Los mejores recuerdos, las mejores amistades y donde desarrollas tu inteligencia emocional. Eso es lo que ellos están perdiendo.
Claro, a mí me preocupa full porque al final uno aprende viendo, ¿no? Y haciendo. Y hay cosas que hay que tocar, hay cosas que hay que ver, hay cosas que hay que oler para en verdad tener noción. Hay que pelear también, hay que abrazarse, hay que discutir, hay que... Y a través de estos aparatos la cosa se vuelve muy superficial.
Uy, me costó mucho. Hacer primero de maestra, de investigadora, trabajar los quehaceres de la casa, correr a entregar mercadería, a sacar el dinero para poder seguir en la lucha. Ha sido muy, muy duro. Hay cosas que yo tampoco entiendo. Entonces me ha tocado... aventurarme, digamos, al internet, yo no sé mucho de computación, me ha tocado muy duro eso.
Casa, trabajo, hijas. Antes era, o sea, el espacio del trabajo, solo trabajo. Llegaba a la casa, cosas de la casa. En cambio aquí, se me llama mi jefa, si es que pasa algo en la cocina, si es que mi bebé también me demanda full.
Yo trabajaba en una textilería, de lunes a viernes, mis hijos quedaban encargados con mi hermana. Pero con esto del COVID nos mandaron del trabajo. La estabilidad económica también ha disminuido. Mi mamá, ella trabajaba antes, por decir, criando pollos, sembrando verdura. Desde que hubo el COVID, ella dejó de hacer todo eso. Ya solamente sembramos para nosotros, para nuestra comida.
Sí fue un poco difícil al principio. Sí, sí me costó. Más que nada aprender que... cómo se hace esto, de la parte tecnológica yo no manejaba mucho, pero me tocó estar más pendiente de eso. Pero después ya me gustó porque yo no había disfrutado esto en casi 12 años, entonces ahora recién podía estar con ella todo el día.
La hija de una empleada mía que era hace tiempo me contó que les van a dejar hojas todas las semanas para que estudien los niños. Pero bueno, ¿y qué más nos toca con esta pandemia? Pero y en el campo, no sé, creo que ya se está reactivando, ¿no? ¿No?
O sea, no podemos enseñarle a un trabajador del campo con lenguaje académico avanzado o cosas que son ajenas a su realidad. Porque para él, a lo que se dedica para su vida, no le va a servir.
Yo veo que es muy, muy trabajoso para los padres de familia. No es como la presencial, ellos ya vienen bien abiertitos, o sea que ellos vienen, almuerzan, entonces de nuevo sientan a hacer los deberes, y mientras aquí no, aquí vuelta, no capta casi nada, se pataletea porque no entiende. Es que todo solo al internet y a veces salen las pantallas, a veces no salen, y ahí no pueden hacer los deberes. Entonces ahí yo veo que se equivocan las guaguas. Yo sé que las profesoras les ayudan, les intentan para hacer, pero no queda bien porque no son así presenciales. En especial de mis hijas, y ellas no tienen acabado el colegio, entonces no pueden ayudar todo. Entonces ahí se equivocan las guaguas y no pueden hacer los deberes. Hemos sufrido mucho este año.
Para ser maestros, o sea, estudian, pero para nosotros es difícil porque como ella dice, hay veces que no entiende las cosas y yo tampoco entiendo. Y a veces como que yo me altero y yo le digo, pero ¿por qué no tomaste atención? ¿Yo cómo te ayudo? O sea, trato de ayudarle, pero no puedo. Y a veces me altero a tal punto que a veces yo le llego a dar duro a mi hija.
Me ha costado quedarme concentrada porque solo los porque solo tenía una pared y nada más, y con una pizarra y la maestra. Y en cambio aquí, en mi casa, tengo muchas cosas con entretenerme y me distraigo.
Para mí es como si dijera que no aprenda nada, porque solo paso viendo la pantalla y casi no se aprende porque estás ahí en el celular y cuando estás viendo y estás en otras cosas y no es como estuvieras en la escuela y estás aprendiendo, estás viendo cómo te enseña el profe, sino que ahora en Zoom que solo te van enseñando, te van hablando solo por la cámara y se siente como raro, como si no estuvieras en clase.
Era más fácil en la escuela porque ahora yo no entiendo nada. Antes en la escuela explicaban ahí tal cosa que no entiendes, te hacen pasar al pizarrón y la maestra ahí te explica. Ahora uno no entiende, el Zoom está fallando, el internet te saca de las clases.
Que a veces el internet se iba y si te perdías un minuto de clases ya no entendías nada.
O sea, estás solo en el móvil, ahí con problemas de conexión, con un audio horrible.
Estudiar virtual este año ha sido muy complicado, sobre todo muy estresante porque se ha vuelto un estudio de 24 horas, 7 días a la semana y ya no con un horario fijo como era antes. Entonces sí es el doble de trabajo, el doble de estrés y a la final no se aprende tanto.
Mi hermana tiene 10 años. Ella tiene clases en la mañana y de ahí toda la tarde pasa haciendo deberes. Entonces ella a veces termina de hacer tareas a las 10 de la noche.
No, pasé a los deberes, no atendía, me estresaba y pasaba con dolores de cabeza. Como que lo que necesitábamos más era como que hablar de lo que nos pasaba, pero solo nos mandaban deberes y nos daban materia. Ya no había la misma interacción que había en clase y no se aprende nada.
Los profesores no tienen buenos métodos para enseñanza virtual y se dedican a pasar diapositivas o a leer PDFs y no buscan una manera más interactiva con los estudiantes para que podamos aprender.
Uno de los objetivos del Ministerio de Educación es brindar una educación de calidad y calidez. Desde mi punto de vista, no se está brindando ni una educación de calidad, peor de calidez. Los niños están en una computadora, entonces no hay ese lazo de maestro-alumno, alumno-maestro.
Escuela, siempre hemos tenido esta organización cuadrada desde el edificio, donde estandarizar a la gente y mantener el control e impedirles ver un poco más allá.
Se pasó a normalizar una cosa totalmente conductista de nuevo. Ahora los chicos no pueden apagar la cámara, no pueden pestañear, no pueden irse al baño. Es una cuestión disciplinaria horrible.
Para mí, las escuelas son panópticos dispensadores de educación.
Entonces, la escuela es un aparato que ha servido para estandarizar a la gente y para mantenerla bajo control. Muy pocas escuelas han apostado por campus más verdes, por campus con otro tipo de espacios, con otro tipo de concepción.
Lo que hay que hacer es cambiar toda la metodología de educación para que la gente piense diferente. Hay que enseñarle a la gente desde sus contextos. La educación, lo que se debería enfocar es por hacer a las personas libres de pensamiento.
Creo que es un buen punto para cambiar y dar ya cabida a otros sistemas de educación, otras formas de ver la vida. Un tiempo ya para demostrarnos que el contacto tú a tú no tiene que ser en un bloque de cemento, ni uniformados, ni en fila. Todas estas crisis globales yo creo que son para desquebrajar el sistema grande. Espero al menos eso.
Arte para mí es una cosa que nos inventamos y podemos hacer de cualquier forma y de cualquier cosa.
Para mí es expresar tus sentimientos.
Para mí el arte se ha vuelto una manera de protesta.
son maneras de construir posibilidades. Mucha gente se ha refugiado nuevamente en leer, nuevamente en pintar, nuevamente en escuchar o tocar música, y eso ha sido un salvavidas en este momento.
El arte tal vez pueda cambiar el mundo, pero hay muchas personas que piensan que no, y tenemos que todos estar como más o menos de acuerdo para poder cambiar algo.
Hola a todas.
Y hello
todos
everybody.
Espero que hayan disfrutado del video. La good, silla vacía.
They enjoyed the action. María José Machado.
Hoy en nuestra cumbre, así como de todos los diferentes videos que estrenamos.
As well as all the other videos that you've seen today.
Hemos tenido un día muy emocionante.
We've had a really exciting day. We started with the BID president, Mauricio Clavero Corón, who shared a lot of important points with us. For example, investment in culture not only is profitable, but it also generates employment and social impact. He talked about how art and culture form part of the solution for change.
Y por otro lado, tuve el gusto de moderar un excelente panel.
And on the other hand, I was with a super panel with various experts from the region.
Vimos cómo las instituciones culturales
we saw how cultural institutions have had to change and become other type of institution during these difficulties. So we had to reinvent our program at the EIDB, changing it from the physical to a totally digital environment.
Bueno, ahora vamos a cambiarnos al inglés.
Steven, now let's change to English. And Stephen, could you give us share some shorts with about your first panel?
You're on mute.
What a remarkable day it's been, and I've just taken some notes about the panels. And for the first panel, Manuela, what I thought was so interesting is that, of course, museums need to think about themselves in the time of the pandemic, where everything has changed, everything became remote, how they relate to different audiences. And that's what we heard from Amanda and Maria Belén, who were talking about the museum as a public space. Belén saying that museums and art are essential to the critical debate of society, and the way that the digital, as we move forward, is going to have a stronger role, and as a way, of course, of reaching out to specific audiences and larger audiences. And Victoria talked about it as an archive of the present. The way that one thinks about that for children, for women, for others, that the development of society is captured and can be played back in a sense and enlarged through the museum. And then Tomas, of course, speaking for the bank, talked about the importance of culture's recovery and the way that technology, of course, will be crucial to the cultural industries. So Belén, again, spoke about including different disciplines of all kinds, use of different platforms, use of technologies. And I think that's those are the takeaways from the first panel. So I'll turn back to you, Manuela.
Thank you, Stephen.
Thank you, Stephen.
Bueno, por otro lado, les contamos que también tuvimos a un invitado muy especial para la charla visionaria.
We also had a really special guest who we'd like to give extra thanks to.
El maestro Gustavo.
The maestro Gustavo Dudamel.
Que él considera que durante estos momentos es cuando más necesitamos unificar.
He commented that it's at this moment when we most need to come together as a society. And when this recovery should also be social healing. He told us about all the projects that he's doing with thousands of musics, giving them instruments, intensive musical teaching, academic support, and leadership training. It was really inspirational to listen to the different advice from the maestro for the communities of this creative ecosystem. Above all, how we can find solutions and ways of recovery through art and creativity, working with arts and culture, with attention and discipline, respect for others, and with a spirit of collaboration.
So, thinking about the second panel, Trinidad really framed it beautifully by asking how will cities be transformed through technology, considering what's happened with the pandemic, how culture is deeply involved in this kind of reframing of infrastructure, transportation, architecture. And we heard from Charles a series of E's. He talked about enlightenment, empowerment, entertainment, employment and economic impact, and the way that the past is connected to the present and the possibilities, he said, of great places. As we think about cities moving forward with creatives, as he noted, as great storytellers. And then Tatiana moved this from the general sense of the city to the domestic realm and how the house is at the center of this. And I thought that was fascinating to think about, as she put it, the rituals of care and the way that we need to rethink the home, rethink the domestic environment as a kind of starting point, a ground zero for health, education, the way that social spaces work. And then we heard from Carolina saying that the important thing for us to be thinking about as we rethink cities is inclusion. She said and repeated, who isn't here? How do we need to think about this in who is taking the decisions, and that from the very start of any policy making, we need to be involving all realms of society to create inclusive spaces. And Tatiana then at the end, speaking for the bank, spoke about the material dimensions, the sense of belonging of cities, and that this inclusive approach, which Carolina spoke about, is a way to ensure that vulnerable populations can stay in their neighborhoods, that we can go from there as a start. So I'm going to turn now just to a kind of summary to just say a few words about the wonderful artworks that we saw today that Manuel and I had the pleasure of working with these different artists. And, you know, I guess what I would say is that the intriguing thing about these new works was the way that these artists are thinking about the individual and the collective. And we see that in each one of these works, how the artist can move forward in what we could call felt knowledge, the knowledge of feeling through these works. In the first case, of course, Bijari thinking about cities and the way we can make green spaces in cities to transform that kind of enjoyment that Charles Landry was also speaking about. And then Lorena speaking about the crucial issue that we've seen in the pandemic, that domestic violence has increased and we need to move forward and think and act toward repairing these situations of violence and discrimination. And then Maria Jose was speaking about education and the way that education has been impacted in very difficult, challenging ways. And yet there is a way forward in the way that we rethink education in a hybrid vocabulary of platforms going forward. So Manuela, I'll turn back to you to talk about tomorrow.
Wonderful, Stephen. Well, this is so exciting, and we want everybody that was connected today in our audience, that we had wonderful comments and feedback, lots of engagement, to continue the conversation, to continue through the YouTube chat, commenting about what are your thoughts about this summit. Y ahora vamos a pasar un momento a español para contarles rápidamente, ya para cerrar nuestra cumbre el día de hoy.
I just want to tell them very quickly to close our summit of the day.
Cómo hacer nuestra programación. Entonces empezamos
that
el día.
They should, that you can know what tomorrow is going to be like.
Tone, subdirector general cultura.
So we're going to start with the subdirector for culture of the UNESCO.
Paso número 4 de los artistas que hemos comisionado de artistas.
And then we'll have the fourth step in the healing.
En colaboración con Amir
Denton, from Trinidad and Tobago,
Shu, y
Christopher Cossier,
y luego seguiremos por
with his collaborators,
sobre el poder de los artistas,
and then we'll have a panel moderated by Stephen, which is about the velocity of reaction of artists looking for responses in crisis. And then we'll close with the last virtual work, Patricia Dominguez from Chile,
el paso número 5 de
closing our summit with the fifth step in healing.
En la herida ya sanada. Y ya cerramos con las conclusiones de la cumbre junto con Stephen. Así que los agradecemos a todos y gracias a todas las instituciones culturales que se han sumado a apoyar nuestra cumbre Cómo Sanar un Mundo Herido. Muchas gracias y nos vemos mañana.
So we give many thanks to everybody who's taken part and we'll see you tomorrow. Chao, chao.